All right, everybody. First of all, let me make this full screen. And then, can I get a quick show of hands? Who in here has heard of styled components? Jesus. Who in here uses styled components? Raise your hand, raise your hand. Who in here likes styled components? Raise your hand, raise your hand, raise your hand. Well, that's almost everybody who uses it. Oh, I expected all the hands to go down. That's good. Thank you. In case you don't know who I am, I'm Max. I come from Vienna, which is in Austria. That is not Australia. I did not fly halfway around the world. It was a two-hour trip, just to be clear. You would be surprised how many people go, oh, hey, I'm from Austria. And they go, kangaroos? Kangaroos? I work at GitHub now because they bought my last company called Spectrum. And I wanted to take this chance to reflect a bit on the tech choices we made at Spectrum and kind of the ones I regret. To give you a little bit of background, Spectrum is an open source chat app for large online communities. We started building it in 2017, I think. So it's been 2 years, pretty much. And many, many open source projects use it, like the Next.js community is on there, the Styled Components community is on there. And it's essentially a real-time chat app. It's like Slack, but public and threaded. Now, we've had some unique challenges. And as three people, we also had to make sure that we chose the right tech. We're three people with a predominantly front-end and design background, right? I was the most technical of us three, and I'd never really built a production backend, never mind for a real-time chat app that many thousands of people use concurrently. We made quite a few mistakes with our check choices. And I have four specific ones that I want to talk about today. The first one is not using React Native Web. Now, in case you don't know what React Native Web is, React Native Web is a project by Nicholas Gallagher, who used to work at Twitter and now works at Instagram. And it was he built it to basically take React Native code and render it to browsers. That means you could take the exact same code that you wrote for your React Native app and render it as a website. For us, we had to start with a website. Spectrum is a chat app, but it is public, and a big part of the appeal is that it's search indexed. All the chats that are on Spectrum are completely search indexed. If you search for a Next.js problem on Google, it's likely that you will find a post in the Next.js community on Spectrum. The search indexing meant that we just had to start with a website, even though chat apps really work best as mobile apps, right? Many of you probably use many chat apps every single day from your phones. Now, we had to start with a website due to the search indexing, but we really needed mobile apps. Our users, that's pretty much the number one feature they request. So we started building mobile apps, but it's taking us a long time, right? Spectrum is now 2 years old, so there's a lot of features and a lot of things that we built that we now have to rebuild entirely from scratch, which is very annoying. React Native Web would have made that a million times easier. We could have written our app once for React Native, and then taken pretty much the same code and rendered it for on a website. Now, I probably wouldn't have gone all in, right? I probably wouldn't have taken just a mobile app and put it on a desktop. I would have built a base component library in React Native Web and then just reused those base components, like your buttons, your headers, your cards. All of those components, they're exactly the same, no matter if you look at them on mobile or on desktop. So React Native Web would have saved us so much time. I really, really wish we'd used it. Another thing I learned through this experience is that it really would have made sense to go mobile first. Even though we had to build the website first, we should have optimized it for mobile. And the reason is that a mobile experience on desktop is fine, right? It's a little bit strange sometimes. Maybe stuff is a little bit too big, but it's usable, right? On the other hand, a desktop experience on mobile is horrible. It's absolutely horrible. If you zoom in, it's completely crappy. So we built the desktop experience first, and then we thought, oh, we'll just add some media queries, right? We'll just add some media queries and make everything work beautifully on mobile. But that's not how it works. It's much, much harder to convert a desktop experience to mobile than a mobile experience to desktop. So the first big lesson that I'm taking away from building Spectrum is that building a good product is all about experimentation, right? It's all about iteration. And you should optimize, or we should have optimized, our tech choices for that speed and the flexibility, right? We didn't know where we were going, right? Our product evolved immensely over the past 2 years. It's completely different than what it was when we started out. But we could have done more to, from the get-go, set us up for this quick iteration, quick changes, and then also being able to reuse the code on different platforms. My second regret is also related to the search engine optimization, and it's not using Next.js. Tim is here today, and I cannot say enough good things about Next.js, and he didn't pay me to say this. Next.js is the best thing ever. We had built a prototype with Create React App, and Create React App is great, right? I don't mean to say anything bad about Create React App. It's an amazing project. But we knew we needed server-side rendering, right? Search engine optimization without server-side rendering is a no-go. You cannot do anything. And yes, client-side, Google kind of indexes client-side rendered apps, but if you have data fetching after the initial render, they won't index your content. So it's great that they will index our loading spinner, but that's not what we wanted, right? We wanted the content to be search engine indexed. So we needed server-side rendering. So then I went, server-side rendering, how hard can that be? I'm just going to build my own server-side rendering server, right? It can't be that hard. Except it's extremely hard. We've struggled for 2 years to make our server run reliably and with the performance that our users expect. Next.js is a framework that, in case you don't know it, you really should know it, but in case you don't know it, is a framework that basically gives you a server-side rendered website out of the box. And it does everything right. They've spent years optimizing the development experience, the performance, the bundle splitting, everything. There's no person on the planet who knows more about server-side rendering React apps than Tim. Nobody, I can tell you that. And Next.js shows that. I use it for all of my new projects now, and it's just amazing. And I really, really wish I hadn't thought that building a server-side rendering server is easy, because it's not. And Next.js makes it extremely, extremely easy. So my second lesson here is that you should probably use existing solutions to problems that you do not understand deeply, right? I had no real idea what it meant to build a server-side rendering server. I'd never done it. I just figured, how hard can it be, right? In the React docs, it's a single function. Can't be that hard, right? Render to string, and we're good. But actually, there's a lot more complexity involved that I did not know about and that I did not understand. You have to handle the CSS. You have to handle the data fetching. You have to handle caching. You have to handle performance. There's so many things that you need to optimize. And we had to do all that manually, and it still doesn't work very well. Whereas with Next.js, I can't repeat this enough, but it's just amazing. It gets you everything out of the box. Now, my third regret is using Rethink DB. We're a chat app, right? Almost everything on Spectrum is real time. The messages, the posts, the online statuses, the communities, everything has to be real time. That's the whole point of a chat app, right? That you can chat in real time. A chat app without real time is not a chat app, it's a forum. And we looked at various databases, but decided to go with Rethink DB because they have this feature called change feeds. And change feeds essentially allow you to listen to live updates on any database query, right? Any database query you run, you put a dot changes at the end, and you get live updates whenever anything changes. That sounded great, right? I thought, wow, we can make everything real time without having to build a separate pub/sub layer or anything. We can just use the database, right? And we'll get all the updates reliably, and it'll be perfect, and everything will be real time. But we've had a lot of trouble with Rethink DB. And again, I don't mean to say anything bad about Rethink DB. The project itself is great. It's just that there's very little usage of it, right? The company went down, and there isn't really that many other companies using it in production, which means there's very little knowledge out there about running a Rethink DB cluster, scaling it to handle the load that we have today, right? So we had to learn all of that by heart which took a long time and had a big toll on our users. We've had probably dozens of outages, mainly related to database problems, right? Suddenly, the cluster not accepting any connections anymore randomly, and our API server crashing, stuff like that. And because there's such a small community around it, debugging these issues often felt like shooting in the dark. We had no idea what we were supposed to do, right? There's no knowledge about operating a Rethink DB cluster. Nobody does that, right? It's such a not widely used technology that there's just no knowledge and no community. It also, in the end, turned out that the feature we chose Rethink DB for, change feeds, really don't scale at all. If you imagine loading a chat app, right, every user has to get a bunch of live updates. They have to listen to new messages, new posts, new users that are online. And so we thought, OK, for every user, we'll just listen to a live database query, right? And so for every user, we started listening to 3, 4, 5 database queries for updates that they expected. But Rethink DB really can't handle any more than 50 or 100 change feeds, right? Which is not enough. So we had to work around this, which is even, we managed to get it done. We managed to work around it, but it took way longer than it should have. And honestly, at that point, we might as well just have built a separate pub sub layer and used an actual database rather than Rethink DB. So there's some more lessons here that I take away from this. One is that you should think about choosing your technologies depending on how hard it is to change them, right? Choosing a database, if you want to change your database down the line like we want right now, it would be a multi-week, if not month, effort. It would take us months to rewrite all of the database query, write data migrations, handle redeployment. It would be a lot of effort, and we can't afford that. On the other hand, you also have things that you can migrate away from much easier, right? If you think about a random NPM module that checks if two objects are equal, right? If that thing has a bug, you can switch to any other of the millions of packages out there, and it'll take you maybe 10 seconds. So thinking very long about choosing which package to choose doesn't make a lot of sense, right? So I've learned that I need to be more careful with choosing technologies that are hard to change later. The other lesson I took away from this is that I really need to prioritize community size and active maintenance, right? Everybody always says that, oh, community size is important and active maintenance is really vital. But it doesn't really hit you until you're in a position where it's 2 a.m., you just got woken up by a pager, and you're trying to debug a database issue with no idea what's going on, no insight, no visibility, no clue what you're even supposed to be doing, right? If Rethink DB had a bigger community, we probably would have had way fewer troubles, right? We could have asked for help, but that was not the case. So next time, I'll definitely prioritize a big community and an active maintenance over any shiny feature there is. And then there's a fourth regret, and that is using draft.js and WYSIWYG editing. Again, Spectrum is a chat app. So most of what people do on Spectrum is writing, right? They write messages, they write posts, they chat with each other. And we thought, oh, we want to make that experience as great as possible. So we're going to build a WYSIWYG editor. Now, some of you at this point might be thinking, you're completely bonkers. Those are the people that have already tried implementing a WYSIWYG editor. Again, we had no clue what that would entail, right? I'd never built a production WYSIWYG editor before. And Facebook had just released draft.js, and I thought, oh, that looks shiny. I want to use that, right? We're going to build a WYSIWYG editor, and it's going to be amazing. Yeah, except it wasn't. We spent months, or at least weeks, but months probably, building a WYSIWYG editor. And then we launched it, and it was extremely buggy. It turns out that building a good WYSIWYG editor is very, very, very hard. There are startups that do just that. They're only reason for existence is that they have a nice editor, right? And really, honestly, this was just a product mistake. We had a million features we could have built, right? Our users were asking us for so many important things like custom emojis and mentions and a ton of other things that a chat app has to have. Why did we build a WYSIWYG editor? In hindsight, that was the most useless feature we could have built, right? Our audience is developers. They know Markdown. You all love Markdown, right? Developers write Markdown all day long, every day. We had a Markdown editor. We should have just kept it. right? It was perfectly fine. And in fact, now, 1 year later, we've actually just rebuilt everything back to being a plain Markdown editor. So if you go on Spectrum today, you just write plain Markdown, and then we render it on the client, and that's it, right? And there's no big WYSIWYG, no draft.js, nothing, right? It's just a plain text input with Markdown. And honestly, the experience is so much better. Now, again, I don't want to necessarily say that draft.js is bad or anything. Draft.js is an awesome framework, right? And it's obviously used very successfully at Facebook. And while another framework could have maybe worked better for us, really, we should just have not built WYSIWYG editing, right? That was just a bad idea and a bad product decision. There's two lessons I take away from this. The first is that you need to be very, very, very careful with cutting-edge technology, especially if it's technology that takes a long time to switch away from. Switching away from draft.js wasn't too hard, but it still took a couple weeks that we basically just wasted, right? We could have built a million other things. And in the future, I personally will also bias way more towards conservative choices. The other lesson is that I really need to be more open with my roadmaps of my products, because our users are going to tell us what they want. And I can guarantee you they would not have told us that they want WYSIWYG editing, right? Had we just listened to our users, and that is such an easy thing to say, right? But when your head's down, building a startup, trying to ship, sometimes you lose track of that, right? Sometimes you lose track of talking to your users. And as dumb as that sounds, had we just talked to our users, we would have avoided months and months of effort and pain. All right, that's all I got for you today. Thank you very much for having me.